Hari Om. With the grace of Pujya Gurudev, we are beginning a new series, The Journey Within. Exploring Vedanta, the science of life. In this series, I have selected 5 important texts. Upadesha Sara, the first one, then Tattva Bodh, Drigdrishya Vivek, Sri Dakshinamurti Stotram, and Saddarshanam. These are 5 very important texts, and these 5 texts will help us to take this journey within. We have been taking many external journeys, but this is a very important journey which we have to take ultimately and recognize our own self. Before we take up the text, we will try to understand what is this Vedanta and how it will help us to take this inner journey. And why exactly we have to take this journey? What is the aim and purpose of this journey? See, for this we have to go back to basics. That why we do what we do, whatever we do in life. What is the purpose behind? People do various types of things and follow different paths. But what propels us to take this journey, whether inside or outside? So if we look at it, we will find that all of us are propelled by our own desires. We are propelled by our desires. Whether the desires are prompted from the world outside, or they come within, ultimately we are prompted by desires to do whatever we do in life. The scriptures also say that even this birth is possible or made possible because of desires. We have some unfulfilled desires which have propelled us to take a particular form and live in this world. So all of us, we are propelled by desires. And why desires is? Desires are wants. I want. So that desire comes, I want. And that want propels us into action. So if we analyze, we will find that we have to find out what are the wants which we have. What do we want? What are the... Because unless these desires are fulfilled, there is no satisfaction, we don't feel comfortable. We are propelled to fulfill those desires. If you are sitting quietly and suddenly some desire comes, that will make you restless. So you want to again be quiet, again be peaceful. But that desire will not allow us to be peaceful. So we have to satisfy that desire. So there are certain desires which we cannot neglect them. We have to, some physical bodily desires are there, needs, which we have to satisfy. So all this, the whole game of this life is revolving around desires. Our great Rishi Munis, they analyzed these desires and they came to the understanding that if we can become free of desires, we will become free of all our problems itself. There are two ways of dealing with desires. One is the worldly way, another spiritual way. But both the ways are meant to remove those desires. Suppose I get a desire in my mind that I want a particular object, then and that desire will make my mind restless. The desire will make me feel incomplete. It will make me feel miserable. So I have to fulfill that desire by my own effort or propelling someone to put effort on my behalf. So husband, wife, family members, friends, anyone can help. So when the desire comes, one method is to fulfill that desire by obtaining that object. When I have the desire to have an object, then put forth effort and get that object. Either desire to obtain some object, desire to go somewhere, desire to change something, desire to destroy something. Different desires can be there. Even desire to destroy. So when that desire comes, I become restless and I am propelled to act. And when I act and fulfill that desire, then what happens? The desire subsides. And when the desire subsides, disappears, I feel great sense of peace and joy. So that peace and joy which I feel is because of the absence of desire. For that temporary moment, I become free of all desires, I feel a great sense of peace and joy. Even when I am in deep sleep state, where there is no dream, I feel great peace and joy. But I am not conscious of it. But there is great peace and joy. And whenever there are desires, it makes me feel restless. The more intense the desire, the more intense is the restlessness. The more difficult the desire to be fulfilled, the more I feel sad and miserable. And when I come to know that my desire cannot be fulfilled, impossible, then I feel grief, feel pain, deep sense of pain. Pain is there, grief is there, which cannot be then removed by any other things. So this is the external method of dealing with desires, worldly method. So in the world, we try to acquire wealth, position, strength, so that we can fulfill our desires more easily. But many of the desires can be fulfilled with money, so I try to obtain more money, so that I can fulfill my desires. Some desires can be obtained with some power and all, so I try to gain some power, political power or other powers. So this is the worldly method of dealing with the desires. But the great Rishi Munis say that if you fulfill one desire, another will come up. Because there is a vast storehouse of desires within us. So if you fulfill one, another will come. Then again you will fulfill that, another will come. So this will be an ongoing process. There will not be any end to it. You will go on, not only for one lifetime, but many, many lifetimes then. because those desires propel me to take another form so that I can fulfill that desire. Like our dream, when I have great intense desire or something in my mind, that type of dream I dream and it continues non-stop. So this is a worldly way of dealing with desires. Rishi Muni has found out that this great storehouse of desires which we have cannot be exhausted just by fulfilling them. So we have to find out what causes these desires and remove the cause itself. What is that which makes us desire desires? And remove those desires, I mean, remove that cause itself. So it is a more interesting and more holistic approach rather than just symptomatic approach of the world. So then the analysis was done of these desires and they found out that the desires are for certain reason. One is we have desire for our own security, we want to sustain, we don't want to die. We have desire to be secure. Then we have desire to be happy, to gain pleasure. So, desire to be secure, desire to be happy. Then we have desire to be perfect, desire to be better, better happiness, better security. And also, we have desire to be a good. So we seek the to strive to give other person security and happiness. That becomes then dharma. So desire to maintain and protect my own body, mind, equipment is called artha purushartha. Desire to gain happiness or pleasure is called kama. And desire to give other jivas happiness and protection is called dharma. That also comes in us, this desire. So these threefold desires are there all the time. The great Rishi Munis, they found out that we also have a fourth type of desire. And what is that? To get rid of all desires permanently. To become free of this bondage of desires. That is called moksha. To become free of this bondage of desires. So they again further analysis, we found that all beings have similar type of desires, especially human beings and other beings also may not have the desire for moksha and all, but human beings have similar type of desire. So the source of this desire must be one, because otherwise we should have different types. Similar types of desires, everyone wants to be secure, everyone wants pleasure, everyone wants, though the percentage and the quality may be differ, but everyone has got this desire. So the source of this desire must be one. So further understanding analysis and going deep within their own self, the Rishi Munis came to know that this desire which we have is desire for our own self. The Rishi Munis in their deep state of meditation, they came to recognize their own self, which is eternal, which is free from all destruction, eternal, which is the very source of all happiness which is of the nature of happiness itself, which is the very substratum of this entire world, which is always free, Nitya Shuddha Buddha Mukta Swarupaha, yourself, myself, is always free, is eternal, is of the nature of happiness, is the very support of this entire cosmos. Because of the very nature of this self, and not knowing that self, whatever desire we have desire for the self only. When we have desire to be secure, we are seeking the eternal nature of our own self. We don't want to die because we don't die. When we seek pleasure, we are seeking the happiness nature of our own self. When we are seeking goodness, dharma, we are seeking the nature of the self which supports the entire creation, which is the very Aadhaar of this entire world. Dharayate iti dharma. And when we seek moksha, we are again seeking our own self. So then, if we are seeking ourself, it is a contradiction like. Why are we seeking ourself when we are ourself? So it was found that we don't know ourselves. We are ignorant of ourselves. So that ignorance of my own self gives rise to this desire to seek myself, to search myself. And this desire to seek myself comes in the form of desire for security, desire for pleasure, desire for goodness, desire for freedom. It is nothing but desire for myself. All so many desires which we have is nothing but I want myself. I want to be one with myself. This is Vedanta. This is what the Upanishads say. So not knowing myself is creating all these desires and all agitations. So, the Rishi Munis came to the understanding that once we come to remove this ignorance, if we remove this all this confusion and recognize myself as I am, my journey will be fulfilled. My journey will come to a conclusion. So, the whole underlying theme or the purpose of all our sadhana and the Vedanta, the scriptures, is to finally recognize myself as I am. So this journey what we will be taking is to go within. Within means within the body, within our mind, within all the thoughts, within all the very core of all thoughts, and then come to recognize, realize myself as I am. And for this journey, we will take help of the scriptures, take help of the Upanishads. Upanishads are called, they are the praman, they are the means of knowing myself. Like a mirror. Upanishads are like mirror. Upanishad doesn't create the self. Upanishad just shows us our own self. They are like mirror. So suppose I feel that there is something on my face, some dark spot is there. I feel little uncomfortable. Then I look into the mirror and I find that there is no such thing. That my face is fine. Then when I don't look at the mirror also, I am very happy. Sometimes it happens. You go to a party and all, and suddenly everyone starts looking at you, surprised. So you wonder what happened. I just came back from the beauty parlor and why people are staring at me? Finally, I come to know I forgot to remove the mud pack. Whatever. So for that you have to look into the mirror. But here, similarly, we don't know ourselves and we have a false notion about ourselves. Therefore, we need a mirror to look and check it out. And when we look into the mirror, all this false notion gets eliminated. And that mirror is Upanishad. Upanishad themselves are called Vedanta. Whatever be the various religions which are there in the world and various philosophies in the world, whether they accept it or not, the very core and the very origin of all of them are the Upanishads. They are very, very ancient and they are considered, they are the revealed scriptures, part of the Vedas. Very ancient. So Vedas are very vast and Vedas have many other topics also. See, there was no division between religion and material science and all in the good old days. Those division, I think, came later on. Vedas talk about science. Vedas talk about spirituality in the same terms. The same Vedas have what you call subjects like astronomy, astrology, mathematics, architecture, warfare, chemistry, physics. And the same Vedas talk about karma kanda, talks about the swarga. And the same Vedas in the end talks about the supreme reality, which is beyond all these names and forms. All this world, including swarga and narak and this world, is like an appearance on the substratum of this great reality. So Upanishads are the most sublime revelation of Ishvara, and with the help of this Upanishad, we can know ourselves. They are like the mirror. They help us to reveal, to remove all false notion and come to recognize myself as I am. So these Upanishads are called Vedanta. Vedanta is just a term used for Upanishads. Vedanta means end of the Vedas. They are found in the end portion of the Vedas. Therefore, they are called Vedanta. Upanishads are called Vedanta. So whether we call them Upanishad or Vedanta is the same thing. And there are many Upanishads and all of them reveal the nature of our own self. Just as if I want to see my face, there might be so many different variety of mirrors. But the mirror should be good quality. They can then reveal the face properly. But there may be more, there are more than one mirror. Similarly, there are many Upanishads and there are authentic about 108 Upanishads. Out of them, about 11 Upanishads are considered very important and major Upanishad. And on these 11 Upanishads, Bhagwan Shankaracharya ji has written commentary and many other Mahatmas, they have written commentaries so that we can comprehend this Upanishad more easily. So Upanishads are praman, means to remove all ignorance, and when the ignorance is removed, I come to recognize myself as I am. The Upanishad guides us slowly and steadily toward the state of enlightenment, wherein I come to know myself, by myself, in myself. So Upanishad acts like a catalyst. In chemistry also we talk about this term, catalyst. They don't do anything, but without them nothing happens also. They don't participate in the reactions, but without them nothing happens. Similarly, the Upanishads are like catalysts. They help us to reveal, to recognize our own self. So Upanishads are called Vedanta. Upanishads are revealed knowledge, revealed to the realized masters, revealed in the state of deep meditation. The truth was revealed in the state of deep meditation. So there are Upanishads like Isha, Ishavasya Upanishad, Kena Upanishad, Katho Upanishad, Prashna Upanishad, Aitriya Upanishad, Taitriya Upanishad, Chandogya Upanishad, Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, Kaivalya Upanishad, Shvetashvatara Upanishad, Amrita Bindu Upanishad. So many Upanishads are there. And study of this Mandukya Upanishad, Mundaka Upanishad, study of these Upanishads help us to recognize ourselves with the help of a good teacher when we study and follow the path shown. And the path, threefold path, Upanishads tells us, listen, reflect and meditate. Upanishad says that you listen to me, then reflect on what I am saying and meditate. Because what you are seeking is not something out there, but you are seeking yourself. So for that, action is not required. Recognition is required. Knowledge is required. So Upanishads help us to gain this. So Upanishads are called Vedanta. Then even the great realized masters of modern times or of ancient time, whatever they spoke, whatever they revealed about this state of enlightenment, they are also equally important as the Upanishads. So they are also called Vedanta. Though the original word for Vedanta is used only for Upanishads, but all the scriptures which are directly, which talks about the same truth revealed in Vedanta, Upanishad, they are also indirectly called Vedanta, like Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita is also called Vedanta. Bhagavad Gita is also called Upanishad. Therefore, after each chapter, we have Om Tat Sat Iti Srimad Bhagavad Gita Su Upanishad Su. So Bhagavad Gita is also Upanishad or Vedanta. Then there are texts like Brahma Sutra, which is also based on the Upanishad. It is also called Vedanta. Then the great realized masters, Bhagavan Shankaracharya, wrote many commentaries, and he also wrote many texts which help us to comprehend this Upanishad. Those are also called Vedanta. So they are as valid as Upanishad. Upanishads are the revealed knowledge which was revealed to a realized master. So whether the realized master of the old or the modern realized master, what they speak is Vedanta, what they speak is Upanishad. In modern times, we have so many great masters, but one of the most wonderful and the most revered master of recent time was Bhagavan Ramana Maharshi, who also attain that same state which was attained by the great Rishi Munis of the past. And whatever Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi spoke and revealed is also as authentic and important as the Upanishads. Though the nowadays, no, this text and all are not added into the Vedas, but they are also as important and valid as the Upanishads. So we will study these few texts. One is of Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi, Upadesha Sara, which will give you entry into this sublime knowledge. It's a very beautiful text. Thereafter, we will study few texts of Bhagwan Sri Adi Shankaracharya, Tattva Bodh, which is a very beautiful text which gives you the bird's eye view of the entire Vedanta, the Upanishadic knowledge. Then we will study Drig Drishya Vivek. Drig means the seer. Drishya means the seen. The discrimination between the seer and the seen. To comprehend who is the seer and what is that which is seen. Who is I? Who am I who is seeing this world? And what is this world which I am seeing? Then there is another beautiful text, Dakshinamurti Stotram. Only in 10 verses, Bhagwan Sri Shankaracharya ji gives the gist of Vedanta, the Upanishads. All these are very sublime as we go. And then finally, we will study Saddarshanam. Again, another beautiful text by Bhagwan Sri Ramana Maharshi, which will then give us the complete path to dive deep within ourselves. If a person sincerely studies these 5 texts, then no other support, no other thing is required for taking this inner journey. The other text will become like a bonus text. So they are very important. It will be good, nice, if you can attend all of them. Even if you, what you call, certain questions and all, which will get answered as we go along. So don't lose heart. Keep on attending and contemplate on whatever you have heard. Take down notes and follow the path. It will be beneficial. Now we will try to understand the great master before we understand his words. See, when we are studying something, we are studying this text, we are studying Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi only. And studying Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi means understanding and identifying with him. So the text helps us to identify with this great realized master. Because a great master is not different from, a realized master is not different from our own self. So it helps us to comprehend ourselves. So a brief understanding of his life and a teaching before we enter into Upadesha Sara. You must have already heard about him and know about him. So Bhagwan Sri Ramana Maharshi was born on 30th December 1879 in a village in Tamil Nadu. And he was born to a simple family. His father, I believe, was a farmer. They were 3 brothers. And in his early childhood itself, father expired, mother looked after them. Then later on, as he grew, he went to stay with his uncle in Madurai. And he was just a normal child, what we consider normal. Only abnormality he had was that he used to sleep like anything. That also you might find normal. But he was, used to sleep so deeply that even if his friends used to shake him and heat him or lift him and put him somewhere else, he will not wake up. He used to go into that deep state, unaware of the entire world. That was only different. But otherwise, he was just like any other child, going to school. But one day something happened very dramatic in his life, which changed his life. He was in Madurai, near that temple, that small place. And he was during that time in 10th standard or SSC, I don't know, SSC might be 11th standard during that time. That he was gripped by a sudden fear of death. It's a very interesting story. He was gripped by a fear of death. And there was no symptom, external symptom, he was a healthy child. But there was this sudden fear that I will die. And he was alone at home, and on the upper story like, he was alone and he felt that now I will die. But let me find out what is the meaning of this death. Anyway, I will die. So let me consciously die. Let me inquire, let me find out what is the meaning of death. Generally, we hear other people dying. We never hear ourselves dying. Did you hear? Open newspaper, hey, I am dead. We hear only other people dying. Nobody hears their own death. If they are hearing, they are still alive. So, we hear about other people dying. We see somebody dying, but what exactly is death, we will come to know only when we die. Otherwise, it is just inference, some vague idea about what is death. All stories and all. People have funny stories then. Uski atma jati hai and all those things. Then dramatically, sometimes they show in the TV and in the movies and all, some light coming out of the body and entering somewhere else. So all this we will know only when we die, whether we become light or we become darkness. God knows what, whether something remains or something nothing remains. We don't know. It's just inference. All stories about what happens after death. Someone says goes to Swarga, someone says no, goes to Narak or goes to Kailash or Vaikuntha. This, all so many stories are there, which are all inference, which are hearsay. So Bhagwan thought that let me discover, find out for myself. Let me experience that death. And let me hasten that death also so that I can consciously experience it. So he laid himself on the floor and he wanted to imitate that death. So he made his body very stiff. He says that when a person dies, the body becomes stiff. So he made his body stiff and he started observing. That even when the body was stiff, he thought that people, if they check, they will say he's dead. But my thoughts are still there. So thoughts are the one which makes me alive. Thoughts are still there. So he then started looking at his thoughts and eliminating those thoughts. And then all the thoughts started eliminating, his breathing also became almost nil. It was something like a near death. experience for him, breathing also almost stopped, thoughts also stopped, and no thoughts were there. Even I thought was not there, but there was a thoughtless, deep experience that I am still there. I am not dead. I am existing. He came to recognize directly with his direct experience that I, the innermost core of my own being, doesn't die. This I, the innermost core of my being, doesn't depend on thoughts. Even if thoughts are not there or they are there, it doesn't matter. This core of my being doesn't depend on the body. Whether the body is there or it is not there, it makes no difference to me. It's like my dress, whether it is there or it's not there, I exist. Similarly, whether the body is there or not, I exist. He came to experience that mystic experience of his own self. See, this may not be happening with everyone. Maybe he was a great yogi of his past life and something remained and he continued with his sadhana here. But he reached that state of samadhi, reached that state of nirvikalpa samadhi, just like that, without any preparation, without any previous study of scriptures, without any guru, without going to Tirtha Yatra or anything. He just experienced this state of enlightenment and he remained like that for a long time. Then again he became conscious of his body, he became conscious of the world, became conscious of the thoughts. But then that fear which was there disappeared. And he looked at this world, came to know that world is just a mere illusion on me. I am that supreme consciousness, pure, eternal consciousness in which this whole world is merely an appearance. Like a person waking up from dream comes to know that whole dream was just an illusion. Then again, suppose he enters the dream. Sometimes we do. Sometimes we know that this is dream, but let me enjoy the dream. So like that, he could see the world, but come realize that whole world is merely an appearance in me. So he reached that state of enlightenment by chance, not by chance, but because of his past sadhana. But outwardly there was no sign of any sadhana or any spiritual practice. So he experienced that and the whole view of the world and everything changed instantly. There was total transformation. And he started behaving differently, externally. So his brother was there. And his brother noticed that this fellow, my brother, he doesn't study. Doesn't take interest in his school and studies and all. So one day he just taunted him. That what are you? You are behaving like a hermit, staying in at home and behaving like a sadhu or something. What is wrong with you? So Bhagavan Ramana Maharshi just listened to him, and he said, "Yes, I am staying at home and behaving like a sadhu. Why not stay somewhere else and be a sadhu?" So he decided to leave that place and go, his home. He had, as a child, heard the word Arunachalam, but he did not know where it is. See, there is always some past life connection. If we have done some sadhana in our previous life, we get attracted towards it unconsciously. So Bhagavan Ramana Maharshi was unconsciously attracted towards the word Arunachalam. He did not know what it is, where it is, how it is. Then once some relative had come and he mentioned that it is the same as Tiruvannamalai, that hill which is the form of Lord Shiva. Lord Shiva himself manifested as that hill, mentioned in the Puranas. So Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi thought that let me go to Arunachal. There is a call, inner call as though. So his brother gave him some, he came to know that it is far away and one has to go by train and all. So his brother had given him 5 rupees to pay for his fees. So he took some 2 rupees from that and he wrote a note to his brother that I have not paid your fees and this is leaving, I am leaving this place and going. He did not mention the word I also. He said this is leaving and don't come in search of this. And he left with these 2 rupees or something, with whatever clothes he was wearing. He went to the station, he bought a ticket, but the money was less, so he could buy a ticket only up till a particular point. If Arunachal is here, he could buy till here. So he bought, then he got down from the train and started walking towards it. Then again he had some kundala and all, which he pawned, which he gave, got some more money, again travelled, and finally he reached Arunachal. So whatever money and whatever extra thing was there, he just put it in the, there is a pond there, near, there is a beautiful Shiva temple. So he just put everything there and entered the temple, did namaskar to Bhagwan and said, Father, I have come. So he remained, and that time he was a young boy. So he remained there in Arunachal from that time onwards till finally when he attained Samadhi, when he dropped the body. So in the beginning, Bhagwan, he was called Venkata Ramana was his name. Later on, people gave him the name Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi. He used to stay in the various places there itself near the temple. Sometimes in some mango grove, sometimes in some cave. There are some natural caves there, Virupaksha cave. Then there is one ancient ashram, Skanda ashram. So he used to just stay there in various places and just be quiet and constantly in a state of samadhi only. Never used to talk to anybody. People used to call him Mauni Swami because he was not speaking. And just in his immersed in his, you must have seen the photograph of his early time also, early days. So once he was sitting in that Virupaksha cave and people there used to come to the temple, then that hill is very holy, so people take pradakshina of that hill. And they used to see this young sadhu sitting there. People used to do namaskar and all. So one day one person saw him and he, looking at Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi sitting in that cave, Virupaksha cave, he was in that immersed in meditation. So he looked at him and wondered that, oh, is he Sakshat Brahma only? He looks like Sakshat Brahma sitting in the cave of our heart. That Brahma, which is the all-pervading supreme reality, which is the very substratum of this world, is also in our heart as aham, as that Atma. So this person saw and he remembered this and he wrote on a piece of paper that Hridaya Kuhara Madhye Kevalam Brahma Matram, that in the cave of the heart is that Sakshat Brahma is there. And he left that note there itself as an offering and went away. Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi saw it and he wrote 2-3 lines extra. So this is the very famous and the first composition of expression of Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi after his state of enlightenment. Just as Guru Nanak Dev expression is there as Ek Onkar and all, Like that, this first expression, Hridaya kohara madhye kevalam brahma matram yaham aham iti sakshat atma ropena bhati. Ridhi vishamanasa swam chinvata majjatava pavana chalana rodhat atmanishto bhavatvam. His entire teaching and the entire nichod, the sar of all the Upanishads, is given in this one verse itself. We will study this verse. Actually, it first comes in Ramana Gita, another text. But it will be nice if you can by heart this verse. So, Hridaya kohara madhye kevalam brahma matram. So, that person has written that keval brahma, that one brahma is in the cave of the heart. Bhagavan wrote further that aham aham iti sakshat atma ropena bhati. This brahma itself is sakshat atma only, which is shining like aham, 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 as I consciousness, not I thought, I consciousness. It shines like I consciousness. So, what should we do? So, ridhi vishamanasa, you enter your own mind, you enter your own heart. How should I enter? Chinvata, through inquiry. Majjata, by diving deep within yourself. Pavana chalana rodhat, by restraining your breath, you dive deep within yourself through inquiry. And what? Atmanishto bhavatvam. You recognize yourself and be established in yourself. Remain as your own self. This is the most beautiful, both the theory as well as practice is given in this one mantra itself. So when that person came, he saw and suddenly he realized that he is sakshat, realized master here. So people started asking him question. Then he started speaking also. And slowly his fame spread. Lot of people came and they could clear their doubts about the deepest tattva of the scriptures. He just knew directly. Doesn't have to read books to tell. So, people have written their own experiences. Many of them have written that they approached Bhagavan Ramana Maharshi with lot of doubts and lot of questions in their mind. But in his very presence, all doubts is to disappear. Miraculously, the doubts is to just go in his very presence. So that was the glory of Bhagavan Ramana Maharshi. He remained there. Then his devotees, other people, built an ashram around him. And he started staying there. And he also composed lot of these little works, many like this Upadesha Sara, then there is Ramana Gita is there, which is his teaching only, written by one of his student, Vasishtha Muni, Ganapati Muni. Then he also wrote Sad Darshanam. Bhagavan was very fluent in Tamil, in English, in Sanskrit. So he translated first he used to write in Tamil, then used to translate it into another languages also, Sanskrit. So this is one of the most beautiful and a small but most beautiful work of Bhagavan Ramana Maharshi, this Upadesha Sara. There are only 30 verses, but these 30 verses are like the nichod, the very essence of the teachings of the Vedanta Upanishad. So it's very beautiful and very important. And in a very simple way, Bhagavan has revealed that knowledge. One wonders why he wrote this. Actually, all his writings were because of some occasion only. A great realized master is like a well, or like an ocean, but let us, like a well, when we put our vessel and draw whatever water we can draw from it. So the limit is only limitation of the disciples, the limitation of the seekers, not the limitation of a master. What comes out of the master is the limitation of the disciples. Master is like an ocean. Disciples have taken whatever, and that itself becomes popular. It's like you draw one bucket of water from the ocean and that make that bucket of water popular. But the source of that is that ocean. The source of all this is Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi himself. A drop of his enlightenment is revealed in few of these texts, like Upadesha Sara, Ramana Gita, Saddarshanam, and he has also composed little poems revealing this great truth. Bhagwan remained in that Tiruvannamalai itself. Later on, his mother also came to know that he is there. She came and she also started staying with him in that ashram itself. He never left Tiruvannamalai. Every day is to go to the mountain, take a round, or just walk around and come. That was the only thing. And Bhagwan lived a very simple life. Though in that ashram, he never had any special privileges and all. He said, should not be everything. Whatever food is cooked, everyone should eat the same thing. And before eating also, he should see that everyone is fed properly. And he himself is to work in the kitchen also, cutting vegetables. And simple. And there, even animals, birds, everyone was given a free, what you call, place to stay. Means there was no fear should be created in the hearts of animal birds also. He never, he used to prevent people from harassing the animals, birds, or even plucking flowers and all. See, it belongs, let it remain wherever they are. So even peacocks, even now actually, if you go to the ashram, peacocks, they come. And monkeys and other creatures, they used to come. Once Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi was sitting in his room and a lot of devotees were sitting there with him. And he used to always sit silently, unless somebody asked some question. He used to be in a state of silence only. And all of them were sitting silently. Suddenly one monkey came with a little one. People got a little agitated and all. So Bhagwan said, don't worry, don't get agitated. So the monkey came and came towards Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi. And he touched the little one. Blessed the little one, and then the monkey left. He says she had come for blessings. So don't have to get agitated. So he used to be in that state of enlightenment throughout. People from India came, visited him. Then there was one person who came from abroad, because of whom then people from abroad also came to know about Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi. There was a writer and a very great seeker also, Paul Brunton. He had written few books, and then he came to know that he knew about India and knew about the glory of India, the great realized master. That is the glory of India. Glory of India, actually people of India itself don't know. Really. So he came to know, and he came in search of these great masters. So first he approached, after moving around here and there, finally he approached a great realized master, the saint of Kanchi Kamakoti Peetham. And he remained with him. And then he had lot of questions and lot of restlessness in his mind. So that Swami told him that you go and meet Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi. He is there at Tiruvannamalai. All your doubts and all your questions will get dispelled. So he came to Tiruvannamalai and he met Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi. And all his confusion, all his doubts, because a spiritual seeker, sincere seeker, he's got lot of confusion, doubts and all are there. And only a realized master will be able to eliminate, remove all these doubts. So he met Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi and he wrote about him in his book, In Search of Secret India. And that book was published and became very famous. People started reading that book. And after reading that book, they started coming, visiting him at Tiruvannamalai. And Indians, when they see foreigners coming, they start wondering, kya baat hai? Yeah. So many of them came from different parts of the world. They came, they remained with him. Great Mahatmas of our own country, they went and visited him. Swami Yogananji Maharaj, he visited. Then Lakshmanju, a great saint from Kashmir, he visited. So many of them. And our own Pujya Gurudev went and visited our Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi. He looked into his eyes. Through his eyes, he is to give diksha. Through his very presence, he is to give diksha. So he looked into the eyes of our Pujya Gurudev. And later on, when Gurudev went to Taponji Maharaj and learnt, he said that I understood what those eyes meant. After studying the Upanishad, I came to know the depth and the beauty of those eyes. Even that time our president was there, Shri Rajendra Prasad ji. And he also went and sat in that room. So as far as Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi was concerned, everyone was same. Whether president was there or this. And if they spoke, he will speak, otherwise he will sit quietly. So he came, he sat quietly and he left. Mahatma Gandhiji could not meet Ramana Maharshi, but he wrote somewhere that it is a great loss that I could not meet him. He wanted to meet, but he could not meet him. So in the recent times, is like a giant, like living Rishi Munis. Actually, even looking at the books, our Upanishads, sometimes we wonder what they are saying. Is it really true? Is it really possible? But when you hear and meet such enlightened masters, you come to know that yes, what is said in the Upanishads are possible. It is possible. It is there. He is the living proof. So Bhagwan taught by his own, he was not like a proactive teacher or something. He taught by his own presence itself. By his mere presence itself was a great teaching. Bhagwan taught through silence. Bhagwan taught through his looks. Bhagwan taught through his own actions. Bhagwan taught through words. So his teaching through his words are available now in various these books. The three most important books which reveal Bhagwan's teachings are this Upadesha Sara, then Sad Darshanam and Ramana Gita. There are other books also, but these are the three main. So we will study this Upadesha Sara. There are only 30 verses, but they are very beautiful. So we'll chant those verses and tomorrow we will see the meaning. Few of the verses we'll chant.